The summer break has finally ended and it's time for round 2 of the 2024 F1 season. Of course, it depends on when you are actually watching this video, but carrying on from where it was left last, this is what the standings looks like. Of course, Max Verstappen is still right on top, but the crazy boom that Lando Norris has had has totally given Charles Leclerc a run for his money, making the overall situation of the Constructors' Cup quite interesting. And that's why adrenaline, tension and drama, these are all the words used to describe F1 and also, of course, the popular Netflix series that put F1 back on the map, Drive to Survive. This is a channel and playlist that talks more about film, editing and stuff of that sort. So sorry if you came here looking for F1 content. But if you became a fan of the sport because of the show in the first place, then do watch this video to understand exactly how Drive to Survive got you hooked. Drive to Survive has done its job in recent past to reignite the love for F1 in fans and onboard new followers of the sport because of its super stylish, well-crafted docu-film style.
All I do is pray for a safe race.
You need to respect the speed, but the second a driver has fear.
But what fans question more and more as the seasons go by is the way they use chopped up radio messages, phony sound effects, and even the use of footage from different races to kind of make interesting narratives that fit their way. In fact, the latest season 6 had even recorded a mass dip in viewership, which was already on a decline from the last season. I mean, we could all call it creative freedom for the greater good and move on. But maybe we arrive at a little bit of a conclusion after a deep dive and a little bit of an analysis. So hello and welcome to this episode of Frame by Frame, where we talk about Netflix's Drive to Survive, its edit strategy, and the kind of things that they have done to keep viewers hooked via film manipulation. Despite all the controversy, truth be told, Drive to Survive has been an absolute runaway success that has had a massive impact on the sport's popularity. In this episode, we'll dive into the initial hype as well as the show's current criticism, which has caused all the love for the show to come down crumbling. When Drive to Survive premiered in 2018, it was a bit of a mixed bag. New and old fans tuned in alike, but it became clear that Netflix didn't have the same level of access to all the teams back then. And accordingly, their approach to stitching the narrative together across these episodes was also different from how they do it today. Let's break down some of each season's key points, cause one thing's for certain, things have gotten a lot more complicated for the show now since then. Looking at the very first season, what absolutely stands out is the chronological approach that they had taken to telling the entire story. This approach, because of whatever constraint they may have had, was actually super kick-ass because it made it much easier to follow the entire season as a whole, as well as see the evolution of the racers through the season.
My career's done. The ultimate goal is to be the best.
More importantly, if you were a newbie, it became much easier for you to understand each and every character, so to say. Basically, the makers chose specific moments for each team across the season and stuck to that chronology in terms of educating and informing you about everything you need to know of F1. For example, this episode, The Art of War, which talked about the Red Bull Renault scene for Ricardo in particular. This was a total standout episode for me because that's when I was like, F1 isn't just about the road and the track. This was the episode that focused on the intense rivalry between Red Bull and their engine supplier Renault.
So have you got any money to spend on your engine now? You spend it all on your driver?
I've got plenty of money.
And as the episode takes us through the confrontations between Red Bull's Christian Horner and Renault's Cyril Abiteboul, all these layers of political and personal drama get added, making viewers realize that F1 is a lot more than just racing. This was the episode in particular where it dawns on you that Netflix doesn't really have access to the top draws like Ferrari and Mercedes, which is why they had to rely heavily on Ricardo's vibrant personality and his transition out of Red Bull. Seems like a total cocker decision for him in hindsight though, huh?
3-4, nutsack 5-6.
That's probably why they also had to very heavily rely on recurring gimmicks like Haas's, Gunther Steiner's incessant abusing, for example.
And now we are a fucking bunch of wankers.
Yeah. This is better. It fucking isn't.
Shit.
This is where you see them adopting gags and the all familiar for the audience to relate to. And you'll see how this carries on season after season, even if things around it change. Once season one blew up, of course, the doors to what was earlier closed suddenly opened up as well. Having become massively huge with backdoor access to the lives of drivers and team principals and hardcore behind the scenes footages of each and every team, there was no way Ferrari and Mercedes were going to sit out from this big opportunity for marketing. I mean, the main reason why F1 fans were even hooked to Drive to Survive at the beginning was because of this unprecedented access into the houses of big, big shots and a look-see into their daily lives. Non-F1 fans who became F1 fans were obviously hooked for different reasons. Mainly because they were never able to imagine this level of drama and politics in a sport like F1. And as this perfect boulder that had something going on for F1 fans and non-F1 fans started rolling down, accumulating more and more momentum, we see a shift in the storytelling in subsequent seasons. With season 2, for example, the progression of episodes wasn't chronological. In fact, things were put together to make more exciting narratives that may not even have been entirely true. Episode 3, Dogfight in particular with Carlos Sainz, for example.
I want to be on top.
With a narrative that suggested that he was struggling more than he actually was. The show depicted him as being in a closer battle with Daniel Ricciardo than what was truly the case. In reality, Sainz was totally killing it. And that's when you start seeing the same recipe play out season after season. The pattern of non-chronology, the use of recurring tropes, and the addition of drama where it didn't exist.
Gene spends 100 fucking million a year of his own fucking money, which fucking wants to pull the plug and let everybody down because you are two fucking idiots.
By the way, I feel a lot of this dude's complexity is completely lost because of the way the show portrays him. From a storytelling perspective though, the makers have gotten this bang on how to cook a plausible story without any recipe. It's crazy how they do it. It's almost as if the ingredients and the masalas are exactly the same, but the dish just tastes different each and every time. There's also a fair bit of drama very craftily brewed by using the same footage again and again in different contexts to keep building tension and amp up that story that doesn't even exist.
You know, they made it out like we're biggest enemies here. Listen. It's forced me off.
That wasn't even from this race.
It
was from a different race.
It's not even near me. Look, it's not even near me.
Maybe not something F1 fans will appreciate, but from a filmmaking perspective, great job using B-roll, I guess. Apart from all of that, F1 fans keep talking about the engine sound and how it sounds fake. Now, I'm not a fan of cars at all, so I can't comment about this. But like I said, this video isn't really about F1 and cars. It's more about how Drive to Survive used filmmaking to make a super positive impact on a sport like Formula One. I mean, we've had kick-ass movies like Ford vs. Ferrari and Rush. Chance to squeeze in my poster here, by the way, which you can buy for yourself on Amazon, the link in the description box. Taking a second to digress actually, since I've made a bunch of F1 posters as well, selling like hotcakes on Amazon, probably something you should check out if you're a fan. But getting back to what I was saying, honestly, even Senna did a wild job on The Great Driver, but nobody has quite done it like Netflix's Drive to Survive in popularizing racing. By the way, if you like the content thus far from a research and film perspective, then please don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. I mean, I rewatched all 6 seasons of Drive to Survive for this, so please show some love. So, in the last 5 years, we've seen a mad jump in revenue for Formula One. And what do you think this can be credited to? One, hundreds of thousands of new viewers accumulated over the years, which means more moolah for the eyes it gets. And two, more advertising boards, costing a lot more with all these eyes on them. Now, of course, if these are the two main reasons why F1's revenue has gone up, then it's safe to say Drive to Survive has played a very crucial part in contributing to the same. And the impact on the masses? Like I said before, those who were casual fans who used to watch a race or two started watching whole seasons. And those who were already hardcore fans of F1 became fans of Netflix.
Netflix are a real bunch of cunts, aren't they?
With such returns reaped though, will the crop continue giving year on year? Hasn't seemed to be the trend in the last 2 years, unfortunately. With the latest seasons doing the same thing of focusing on small problems and hyping them up big time, the show has clearly become too much of a pop cultural touchstone to be the same candid behind the scenes novelty. And there's an increasing self-awareness of the series that has made it all the more indulgent. So with all that, you can see why people are completely split and polarized about Drive to Survive. Hell, even the drivers are split. Here's what Verstappen has to say about its authenticity, by the way. I didn't like it at all, because a lot of it is fake. I know what I talked about with my engineers in one race, which they then used in another Grand Prix just to make it more exciting. That's not okay, that's just sensationalism. And at the same time, here's what Esteban Ocon has to say. I think Netflix has changed a lot of my life and career. In difficult times when I didn't have a seat, that came out and people could actually see I was desperate to have a drive again. And that probably helped my career get back on track. All in all, Drive to Survive has played a monumental role in being a proponent of F1's rise. I mean, F1 being such a niche sport didn't even rank in the top 10 most watched sports until Drive to Survive. And the show, which set out to widen the base, even managed to pull crowds from US and India, pulling it out from this tag of European sport. And yes, there's a ton of maybe Hollywood drama that definitely needs to be addressed and get fixed in the subsequent seasons. But the kind of positive damage that it did in the past is undeniable.
Fuck 'em all.
Hope you like this quick rundown of Drive to Survive and Netflix's masterstroke in producing a series like this that totally revived and popularized F1 again. If you did, then please don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. And I'll see you in the next one. Peace out.